What's up, Cathedral? You guys okay? Before I get started, are there any moody students here today? Yeah. When's commencement? This next week? Is this coming week finals? Have fun with that. All right, 1 Peter chapter 2. Grab your Bibles, go there. Just very interesting book, but let me just share a couple of things. When Sue and I have said, and my wife is here, but she doesn't want me to introduce her, even though she's sitting over there. She doesn't want me to introduce her, so I won't. So we have talked a whole bunch of times about what vanilla lives we have lived. And by that, you know, we mean no huge traumas, no incredibly insurmountable financial setbacks or health issues. We've had our share of challenges here and there, but for the most part, our lives have been pretty much free of suffering. I sometimes wonder how it would go for me if real suffering came into our lives. I would like to think that we would handle it just fine. But you know, we don't know until we actually get there. One of the things also that I think of, and especially relevant for 1 Peter, is suffering for Jesus' sake as a Christian. I've done pitifully little of that. And I think my wife would say the same thing. I do, however, believe that there is more suffering because we are Christians that's coming to our culture and our society. It's happening already. What God loves, the world hates. And God loves the church. And God loves Israel. And the world hates both. You're going to see more and more of that. So we got to get ready. We need to sort of figure out what we're going to do when that happens. So part of my inclination would be I would want to go home, get in bed, curl up under the covers, and just hope the whole world goes away, leaves me alone. Maybe I can protect myself. And yet Peter says, not so fast. You got to do some other things. And those other things are what we're going to be looking at today. Now, just a couple of things by way of context. Let me just mention three themes that are really common in 1 Peter. First of all, there's the theme of glorifying the Lord. It pops up at some key places. I just want to read a couple of verses to you. In 1 Peter chapter 2, and verse 12, it says, "Keep your conduct among the Gentiles honorable, so that when they speak against you as evildoers, they may see your good deeds and glorify God on the day of visitation." 1 Peter 4:16, "Yet if anyone suffers as a Christian," which is what we're going to see today, "let him not be ashamed, but let him glorify God in that name." To glorify God means to celebrate who he is and then to express that to the world. When we express who God is to the world, he receives praise. He receives honor. There is name. There is fame associated with his name. Another theme here is the suffering of believers. Suffering of believers in 1 Peter is mentioned 15 times. 15 times. We know that this is a letter written to people who live in a society that was antagonistic to Christian things. And so some of them were beginning to experience some real persecution. And so, and as we're going to see in a second, 1 Peter 2:19, "For this is a gracious thing, when mindful of God, one endures sorrows while suffering unjustly." In 1 Peter 4:19, "Therefore let those who suffer according to God's will entrust their souls to a faithful Creator while doing good." In addition, the book also talks in every chapter about the sufferings of Jesus. A couple of verses, 1 Peter 1:11. "The prophets inquired what person or time the Spirit of Christ in them was indicating when he predicted the sufferings of Christ and subsequent glories." 1 Peter 5:1, "So I exhort the elders among you as a fellow elder and a witness of the sufferings of Christ, as well as partaker in the glory that's going to be revealed." And he goes on to give instructions to the elders. Interesting, in the passage that we're going to look at, those three themes, the theme of glorifying God, that is enhancing God's reputation, by drawing people's attention to how great he is. The theme of suffering by believers and the theme of Jesus' suffering, those three themes come together in this passage. Now, the immediate context, you know, chapter 2, verse 11, Peter writes, "Beloved, I urge you as sojourners and exiles to abstain from the passions of the flesh, which wage war against your soul. Keep your conduct among the Gentiles honorable, so that when they speak against you as evildoers, they may see your good deeds and glorify God on the day of visitation." We've seen also a little bit before that, verse 9, that we are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people to his own possession. If we are all of that, why do we suffer? Why is it that we suffer? If we're all of that, and how do people who are a royal priesthood interact with the secular authorities and government? Well, that's what we're going to be looking into in our lesson today. So here's the big idea. God will be glorified. That is, his reputation will be enhanced. People will be struck with his goodness. As we live with deference to the various authorities that exist in our lives. And so there's two different commands that Peter gives here that we need to follow. The first is, in verses 13 through 17, is that we need to respect authority. He says in verse 13, "Be subject for the Lord's sake to every human institution, whether it be to the emperor as supreme or to governors as sent by him to punish those who do evil, and to praise those who do good." Now, being subject to secular authorities is a real common theme. You find that in the Bible all over the place. I don't think, however, that it's an absolute injunction. It's not an absolute command. Sometimes the authorities above us might tell us to do things contrary to Scripture. And on those cases, we engage in passive resistance. Not active resistance, passive resistance, and become willing to suffer for Jesus' sake. In fact, it says here, "Be subject for the Lord's sake." Let me just propose that "for the Lord's sake" suggests that as we suffer well, as we live in submission to the governing authorities, it will enhance the Lord's reputation. And if we don't do that, then the Lord loses out on investments that we can make in his glory. Now, the role of government, we know, is to punish those who do evil and praise those who do good. "For this is the will of God," verse 15, "that by doing good you should put to silence the ignorance of foolish people." That's one of the reasons why we live in submissiveness, so we can glorify the Lord and put people to silence. All right. Joe Stoll, in a book entitled Redefining Leadership, talks about this whole idea of silencing the ignorance of foolish people as we do good deeds. Just want to illustrate that. I've got a longer quote here. Hang in there. It goes like this. "Mother Teresa was an unlikely leader. She was a small-framed, bent-over nun who gave herself to serve the slum people of New Delhi in India. Asked to speak at the National Prayer Breakfast in Washington, D.C. on February 3rd, 1994, she delivered a powerful defense of valuing the life of the unborn. Hardly able to see over the podium, she courageously articulated the importance of protecting life. As she spoke, two of the most powerful leaders in the world, President Bill Clinton and Vice President Al Gore, were seated on either side of her, both of them outspoken advocates of abortion." I want to stop here just for a moment and just say to our women folk here, if you have had an abortion, there's forgiveness for that. Because what we're going to do is we're going to go on and talk about that abortion's bad, and Mother Teresa's going to say that. But I wanted to say that to you, that there's forgiveness. So this is what she said, quoting now, "I feel that the greatest destroyer of peace today is abortion, because it is a war against a child, a direct killing of the innocent child, murder by the mother herself. And if we accept that a mother can kill even her own child, how can we tell other people not to kill one another? How do we persuade a woman not to have an abortion? As always, we must persuade her with love. By abortion, the mother does not learn to love, but kills even her own child to solve her problems. And by abortion, the father is told that he does not have to take any responsibility at all for the child he has brought into the world. That father is likely to put other women into the same trouble. So abortion just leads to more abortion. Any country that accepts abortion is not teaching its people love, but to use any violence to get what they want. This is why the greatest destroyer of love and peace is abortion, end quote. Now, that statement drew a standing ovation from the thousands who were there celebrating the prayer breakfast. Joe Stoll goes on to say, needless to say, her comments created a rather awkward moment for President Clinton, whose speech followed directly on the heels of Mother Teresa's. When he began his speech, he said, "It's hard to argue with a life so well lived." Isn't that interesting? One of the strongest advocates for abortion had to say, "This woman lives so wonderfully, how can you argue against her?" And he couldn't, and he didn't. So the same idea is true for us. That is, the world more and more is already saying terrible things about us. Do you know that Christians are the most intolerant people in the world? We're homophobes. We're transphobes. We support Israel. All kinds of things are just being said wickedly against us, that we are wicked. What we have to do is we have to prove them wrong by how we behave. And that means living for the glory of God. Peter goes on to say in verse 16, "Live as people who are free, not using your freedom as a cover-up for evil, but living as servants of God." Now, we've been set free from sin. We know from other scriptures that the relationship of the believer, the one in Christ, to sin as a master over them, that relationship has actually been severed by Jesus as a result of our union with him, by faith in him. As a result of having died to sin, we have a new power available to us to live in a way that pleases the Lord. And pleasing the Lord, among other things, means using this freedom from sin, not to be able to go out and live in a sinful way, but rather to actually live as servants of God. And if we live as servants of God, we're going to end up being better submissive citizens of our country as well. The two things go together. Peter says in verse 17, "Honor everyone, love the brotherhood, fear God, honor the emperor." Now notice here probably what Peter's doing is he's referring to our actions, interaction with society, with church, our own spiritual life, and our political lives. We need to live well in all of these different spheres. And we need to honor the emperor. The word honor here means to show high regard for or esteem for, to attribute high value and honor to somebody by praising them is the idea. It's the same word that's used in John chapter 5, verse 23 for Jesus. John 5, 23, "Whoever does not honor the Son does not honor the Father who sent him." All right, let's stop here just for a second. Pet peeve of mine is how we talk about our political leaders. Your Christian people say all the time, "You know what Biden did? You know what Trump said? You know what Bill Obama enacted? Do you know what Bush did to the economy?" Okay, please note, in verse 17, it says, "Honor the emperor." That word honor, by the way, is an imperative verb. It's a command, not an option. It's a command like, don't get drunk with wine or flee youthful lusts. And so it's not an option. let me suggest that inasmuch as the political leaders are there under the sovereign and providential hand of God, and inasmuch as we are ordered from Scripture to show honor and deference to those leaders, we ought to speak less flippantly and critically of them. And so if I'm going to talk about our current president, I'm not going to say Biden did this or that. Here's what I'm going to say. Mr. Biden did this or that. Mr. Trump, President Trump, President Biden. I also decided a long time ago, because of things like this that are said elsewhere in the Bible too, Romans 13, I just decided I was never going to tell a political joke, you know, about a political leader ever again. And I try not to listen to jokes that other people tell if it's about our political leaders. And if I'm in a position and I don't have any option but to listen to the joke, I try not to laugh. But if I do laugh, I try not to laugh very loud. Because it's just not right. Have you guys heard what I've just said? You might not respect the man, but you ought to respect the office. And you ought to respect the fact that that person is in a position of authority over you because God put them there. That should make it a little easier for us to show honor and respect. So not only are we to respect authority, Peter also says that we are to suffer well, verses 18 through 25. He said, first of all, several reasons why we should. When we suffer well, it pleases God. Peter says in verse 18, servants, be subject to your masters with all respect, not only to the good and gentle, but also to the unjust. Now, back in those days, of course, we're talking about slaves. It's estimated that there were probably around 60 million slaves in the Roman Empire, a whole lot. Perhaps a third, maybe even as high as a half of the population of the Roman Empire were slaves. Now, I want to talk about slavery in New Testament times just a tiny bit. When we think about slavery, we think about what happens in the United States before the Civil War, right? That's what we think of when we think of slavery. But it was very different in the Roman Empire during this time. Let me just read. These are comments from Jerry Peterman in his commentary on the book of Ephesians in the Moody Bible Commentary. He says, slavery in New Testament times was basic and accepted element of first century society. While the practice strikes many of us as perverse and barbaric, we should keep in mind that ancient Greco-Roman slavery was different from American slavery in at least four ways. First, it was not associated with ethnicity. Slaves could come from any nation and race. Second, slavery was rarely permanent. Many gained freedom within a decade. Some were able to save money and buy their own freedom. Others even gained Roman citizenship when freed. Third, for many, slavery acted as bankruptcy. If unable to pay debts, selling oneself as a slave ended the obligations of the creditors, in a sense gaining one kind of freedom. Fourth, many slaves, whether owned by the government or by the wealthy, lived much more comfortably than free men who were poor. And the fifth thing I would say is that Peter seeks to regulate slavery, and so does Paul in his writings, everywhere in Scripture where they write and touch on this. So they seek to regulate slavery here, both for the Christian slave and for the Christian master, but in no way should Peter's words or any other words of any other New Testament writers be taken as endorsement and approval of the institution. In fact, what we find built into the comments on slavery in the New Testament is you find the very elements which will sow its destruction, the institution of slavery. Now, the question then comes up, why don't the New Testament writers, like Peter, like Paul, why don't they just say to the Christian slave owner, set your slave free? Just set him free. Let's not worry about society at large. And why don't they do that? Well, we don't know. It's really a big issue. But let me also suggest that if, in fact, somebody was a slave, in most situations, they would be pretty well taken care of. And if they were set free, they would now have to find their own shelter, their own clothing, their own food. And such things were not so easy to come by for many people who are at the lower levels of society back then, okay? It would be hard to do. And so maybe the loving thing was for the Christian slave owner would be to treat his fellow slave with greater kindness, continuing to provide for him, continuing to meet his needs. Maybe that's the more loving thing. It doesn't sound right to us because of our own background with slaves. But this was a reality in the Roman Empire. And so these could be some of the reasons why Peter didn't say, just let all your slaves free. Verse 19, he goes on, "For this is a gracious thing when, mindful of God, one endures sorrows while suffering unjustly." Now, he says, "For this is a gracious thing." The word gracious here is actually the word grace. This is a grace. Look at verse 20 for more on this grace. "For what credit is it if when you sin and are beaten for it, you endure? But if when you do good and suffer for it, you endure, this is a gracious thing in the sight of God." This is, again, another statement at the end of verse 20. It uses the word grace. So verse 19, verse 20 should be read together. Here's the deal. There's a grace involved, seen in verse 20, as credit that is involved to us. Very interesting thing that's in the ancient world. The word grace, which is the word charis. I want you to say the word charis three times, everybody. And if you don't, that'll be bad. Charis. Ready? Charis. 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 That's what this word is. The word charis is used for God's grace shown to us in Christ, his philanthropic, kind, merciful nature. But also, the word charis can be used for an award that is given to us. And don't turn there. I just want to read a section of scripture to you. In Luke chapter 6, verse 32 to 35, Jesus says, "If you love those who love you, what charis is that to you? What benefit is there? What reward is there in you only loving the people who love you? For even sinners love those who love them. And if you do good to those who do good to you, what charis is that to you? What benefit, what reward do you have by only loving those who love you? For even sinners do the same. And if you lend to those from whom you expect to receive, what charis is that to you? For even sinners lend to sinners and get back the same amount. But love your enemies and do good and lend, expecting nothing in return, and your reward," different word, "your reward will be great, and you will be sons of the Most High, for he is kind to the ungrateful and the evil." See, there's if you only love the people you love, there's not much of a reward. I mean, there's everybody does that. But here, charis is a synonym for the word reward. And so the idea is, here in this passage, is that when we graciously, being mindful of God, endure sorrows at the hands of a nasty boss, that brings reward to us. Now, we Christians don't like the idea of reward. I just want you to know that the Bible is full of this word reward. Jesus himself says, Sermon on the Mount, that when you pray, go into your closet, pray in silence, and your Father who sees you in private will reward you. Your labor in the Lord is not in vain. God's going to reward you for those things in eternity. We think it's a much nobler thing to serve Jesus out of pure love, and it is. But to serve him to get a reward is perfectly okay too. And it's everywhere in the New Testament. Everywhere. And Paul says that, Peter says that here. So what credit is it when you sin and beaten for it, you endure? But when you do good and suffer for it, you endure. This is a gracious thing. This is a reward for you from God that we're going to receive. We don't really talk about future rewards very much, and I get it. But they really are an important part of motivation for us in the Christian life, I think. If somebody were to say to you, I'm going to give you $100 million 60 years from now, on the condition that you're nice to me pretty much the whole time, would you try to be nice to them for 60 years? Would you? Sure you would. Absolutely. Because you want $100 million. And then when you get it, wow, pretty cool. And yet we don't think about eternal rewards. That when we die and step into the presence of God, there are things that are going to be given to us as rewards for having obeyed him sincerely and in the power of the Spirit for his glory and the good of people. There's going to be magnificent rewards. And we just don't even think of that. But we really should. So he goes on. Not only should we do we recognize that suffering well, if you're a slave, in our case, in our setting, if we're an employee, if we suffer well at the hands of a nasty boss, second thing it does, as to why we should do this, is because doing so imitates Jesus. Verse 21, for this you have been called, because Christ also suffered for you, leaving you an example so that you might follow in his steps. Guess what? When we suffer well, when we suffer at the hands of a nasty superior, and we don't retaliate, then we're very much like Jesus, who when he was betrayed and tried, didn't open his mouth. It's really interesting. We know back in those days that if a person was accused of a crime and he was taken to a secular court back then, the person who was accused would always stand up and give a really strong argument as to his innocence, not Jesus. But he left us an example. The word example means a model or a pattern to be copied in writing or drawing. It's a model of some kind of behavior that should be copied. The word example was used for when little kids were learning their alphabet and the letters would be written out for them. They would trace those letters themselves to begin to learn the alphabet. And we are to follow Jesus and imitate him, show him to the world through suffering very much like he did. In verse 22, referring to Jesus, he committed no sin, neither was deceit found in his mouth. When he was reviled, he did not revile in return. When he suffered, he did not threaten, but continued entrusting himself to him who judges justly. He didn't revile in return. And so he took the punishment, and we are to as well. By the way, I got to say this. If your boss has done something criminal against you, call the police. This is not warrant for just laying there like a doormat or something and just taking all the, if there's been a crime against you, call the police. That's not what this passage is about. Going on, it says that if we act like Jesus, it's going to have some influence. Verse 24, 25, he himself bore our sins in his body on the tree that we might die to sin, in order for us to die to sin and live to righteousness. By his wounds you have been healed. Almost universally among some of our friends in the charismatic movement, they look at this as actually a statement promising healing. They'll say there's healing in the atonement. And I'm going to tell you, in point of fact, there is healing in the atonement. But you may not get it now. You will someday. There's also the resurrection body in the atonement. But you don't get it now. You'll get it later. This passage is talking about wounds. By Jesus' wounds, we have been healed. There's a metaphor here. He begins the verse by saying in verse 24, he himself bore our sins in his body. And then in verse 25, it talks about us returning to the shepherd and overseer of our souls. We're talking about sin issues here, not issues related to healing. But Jesus heals us from these things. Verse 25, for you are straying like sheep, but now have returned to the shepherd and overseer of your souls. That's really super important. Remember, Jesus entrusted himself to God when he remained silent and when he was not reviling in return when he was being tried. He trusted God to do what God was promising to do here. And the implication is that we need to be like that as well. We need to trust him. We need to count on him. Notice that this is probably a reference to Jesus, because Jesus is the only one in the New Testament called a shepherd, that we have come to Jesus. He is the shepherd and overseer of your souls. Super important, because we're told, stand for Christ, even if your boss doesn't. And if standing for Christ and trying to uphold Christian values gets you in trouble with your boss, you must remember that that does not take God by surprise. Romans 8:28 is not suspended when we get in trouble for standing for Christian things. There's a couple of people I know who teach in public schools, Christian people. Neither of them have yet been ordered by their administration to start teaching the homosexual and transgender agendas. They've not been ordered to do that. It hasn't come yet. These are Christian people, and I fear for them. When that does come, what are they going to do? If it were me, I would refuse to teach it and be willing to suffer for righteousness' sake. Guys, you and I need to do the same thing. A boss tells us to do something and we know it's not Christian. We need to kindly and respectfully resist and be willing to suffer the consequences, because God might use our stand with Jesus to actually draw them into relationship with himself. And so he's the shepherd and overseer of our souls. We can do these things. We can stand for him because he will take care of us, even if the consequences are threatening. So I have 5 points of application. It's only five. Piece of cake. 5 points. Number one, and I've already said this, let's speak more respectfully of the governing authorities, the positions of people in positions of leadership. At least we should respect the position, if not the individual. Secondly, if you have a nasty boss, then number two, view him or her as God's way to provide a job and necessary income for you and your family. This may make us more respectful. We can thank God for a harsh, hard boss, because among other things, God is using that individual for your income. Third, view him or her as God's way to develop your character and spiritual life. God's going to develop your patience as you continue to do what you ought to do as a believer in a hard situation. Number four, view him or her as a person in need of the grace of God. You may be the only channel of that grace to your boss. Who knows but that your boss might use you someday. And then number five, remember that if you respond in a Christ-like way to a harsh supervisor, there are rewards for you in the prophetic eternal future that are worth waiting for. Don't ever forget that. God will take care of you if you stand for Christ, even when it's really difficult. By the way, there's a couple of references here to Isaiah 53. All we like sheep have gone astray. Each one has turned to his own way, but God has laid upon him the iniquity of us all. There is between us and God this burden of sin that we cannot get rid of on our own. The wonderful thing is, in Isaiah 53 and all throughout the New Testament and the Old Testament, is that you find God taking care of the human sin nature himself. That God has laid upon Jesus the iniquity of us all. Jesus took the punishment for the sins that we've committed. He died upon the cross as that atoning sacrifice, and he rose from the dead, indicating that eternal life is now sourced in him and him alone. The way you make that available for yourself, the way you benefit from that, is by putting your faith in Jesus Christ alone for the forgiveness of your sins. And what that means is that if you're counting on something else right now to get you into an eternal life situation, if it's not Jesus, then set that aside, reject that, and instead turn in faith to Jesus Christ alone, who died for you and rose from the dead, and he will provide forgiveness of your sins. He'll give you power to be able to live like this in this passage that we see. By the way, let me also say, and then I'll be done, if you want to talk about that more, if you're here and you're thinking, you know, that's kind of interesting about having eternal life and what that means, and if you're unclear about it, I'm going to be up here in front after the service. I'd be more than happy to talk with you about what it means to be a Christian and to help you if I can. Let's pray. So, Lord, my guess is that we've all had difficult bosses on occasion, maybe non-Christian bosses. We've all felt the tension that exists with wanting to please our boss, which is right, and in many ways, on a ton of issues, we can. Lord, we can show up early and stay late and please our boss and you at the same time. Father, you got to help us, though, because sometimes it's really difficult to navigate those tensions. But in the final analysis, Lord, I pray that you would help us to so trust you as the shepherd and overseer of our souls, that when we take a stand for Jesus and there are consequences that are painful and signify loss for us, help us, Lord, to believe that you are still in control, you're still in charge, and somehow you'll bring good out of it. I just pray that you would help us to believe that and to have more courage, please, to live for Jesus. Make it so, Lord. We ask in Jesus' name, and all the church said, amen.